League of Legends stat websites are everywhere. OP.GG, League of Graphs, Lolalytics, Blitz, Porofessor, and many more. It doesn't matter which one you use in particular, because at the end of the day, they all do the same thing. Oh, and by the way, I'm obviously not sponsored by any of them. In my opinion, stat websites are undoubtedly a lot of fun to look at. The pick and win rates of all the champions, runes and items can definitely give you a good overview of the current metagame, and most of you seem to really enjoy them as well. However, all of these tools and websites share the same inherent problems that are unfortunately impossible to fix and make most of the data utterly useless, if not outright misleading. And first things first, the point of this video is not to condemn all stat websites and tell you to stop using them, but instead teach you how to use them correctly so they don't lead you to false conclusions, which sadly can happen faster than you might think. I mean, most of you are probably thoughtful enough to be aware of the basics when it comes to win and pick percentages. You know that a win rate of more than 50% means the champion has an overall winning impact in their games, that champions with low pick rates have inflated numbers because of highly proficient one-trick players, and that a win rate of 100% tells you exactly nothing when the sample size is just 2 games. While all this is apparently common knowledge and intuition, many people are not aware of the 2 huge statistical biases that effectively ruin all the data. And yes, I literally mean the data is ruined by them. Even large samples like these Jinx keystones will tell you almost nothing about the viability of those runes. I will tell you exactly why that's the case and how to accurately interpret the data in a second, but I first want to address the smaller of the 2 biases to get you warmed up for this. Statisticians call this first one survivorship bias, and it is luckily not as impactful as it could be because it only affects item win rates and nothing else. The term is used to describe the logical error of concentrating on the people or things that made it past some selection process and overlooking those that did not, typically because of their lack of visibility. This can lead to false conclusions in several different ways, and item win rates in League of Legends are not an exception. The implications of this get more obvious when we look at an example. Some stat websites have this column that reads winning items, and if we have a look at the winning items for the champion MissFortune, we see the following. Those are quite some numbers, right? A more than 60% win rate on Guardian Angel and Edge of Night when MissFortune's overall win rate as a champion is a mere 50.9%? These items must be straight up broken and everyone who doesn't buy them is stupid. Guess you have to rush them every single game now and enjoy your sweet 60% win rate champion. Except that this is obviously not how it works. Both of these items are hyper late game items, and you can only afford to complete these items if you are already winning in the first place. In games where you get stomped and barely have enough gold to complete your mythic, you will have lost the match before you can even start thinking about these items. When you are the one doing the stomping, on the other hand, and you get yourself nice and fed, you will be able to afford these luxury items in addition to your core build, but you probably would have won the game either way, even if you buy a suboptimal item like Zhonya's Hourglass on MissFortune instead. A fed AD carry is just more likely to win than an AD carry who is behind, period. Put simply, Guardian Angel doesn't make MissFortune win more, but winning MissFortunes make more Guardian Angels. Looking at late game items obviously makes for the most extreme example here, but even your core items are affected by a survivorship bias. Let's say you rush Eclipse on MissFortune every single game. Even if you are bad at the champion and have a slightly negative win rate of maybe 49%, chances are the win rate of your Eclipse games is actually above 50%, because in some games you lose so hard that you will surrender without even completing one full item. Yes, the reverse can happen too, and the enemy surrenders early from time to time, but here you will be fed and therefore get your mythic item early enough for it to still enter the statistic. Or in terms of the stat website, MissFortune has a 50.9% win rate, but minus the games where MissFortune loses so hard she doesn't even get her mythic, she wins almost 52% of the time. For some champions, survivorship bias is actually quite nasty. If you are a Twitch player, for example, and want to know whether Twitch's AP or AD build is stronger, you might find yourself looking at the win rates of his respective mythic items. You see that both his common crit mythics and his AP mythic have a rather similar win rate of 54-ish%. Therefore, you might believe that crit and AP are likewise similar in terms of power level, but if you factor in survivorship bias, the numbers suddenly look much different. Because the typical AP Twitch player doesn't even build their mythic until they get to their third item, Twitch's crown win rate for the most part is calculated from games in which the Twitch player could afford at least 3 full items. Crit players, on the other hand, buy their mythic item first, which means this win rate also takes games into account that end way earlier and in which the Twitch player was significantly less fed. AP Twitch's first item, Nasha's Tooth, actually only has a 52% win rate, and AD Twitch gets to a massive 60% win rate on 3 or more full items. In any case, the only way to get rid of survivorship bias is to find a method to still factor in games that ended before the full build could be acquired. Actually, we could do this quite easily. First, Riot would need to implement a pre-game survey in which players have to enter all 6 items they intend to buy. Additionally, Riot would need to put its entire player base under the Imperious Curse to stop them from lying in those surveys, and to further stop them from dynamically adapting their item choices to opposing threats mid-game. Unfortunately, this probably won't happen anytime soon, because using the Imperious Curse against fellow human beings is currently prohibited by wizarding law. But to get back to the Twitch example, even when you try to take survivorship bias into account and the comparison now looks more apples to apples on paper, the conclusion that crit builds would be stronger than AP builds is pretty misleading. This would merely be one possible explanation for the difference in win rates. Maybe AP Twitch is just harder to play, or people opt for AP Twitch when they feel the need to fix a rather terrible full AD team composition, or it is something else entirely. Who knows? And this brings us to the second and arguably more sinister bias that effectively makes an accurate interpretation of the data outright impossible. It is called self-selection bias, and its effects are devastating. Not only item win rates are affected by it, but also rune page win rates and even general champion win rates themselves. In statistics, self-selection bias arises in any situation in which individuals select themselves into a group, causing a biased sample with non-probability sampling. Statisticians have a fancy catchphrase here that describes the phenomenon quite accurately. Garbage in, garbage out. A statistics program, or a League of Legends stat website for that matter, can be as sophisticated and elaborate as you want. But when you feed it with flawed or biased datasets, garbage in, it will always produce useless results, garbage out. The problem is that your champion, item, and rune choices in League of Legends are not random, and unless we make use of the Imperious Curse again, hashtag legalize it, they never will be. To make it obvious what this implies, let's have another look at the Jinx keystones from earlier. Runes are picked pre-game, so survivorship bias is a non-factor at least, but we still have to be careful with sample sizes. As we've noted earlier, a sample size of 1 or 2 is useless, but when exactly does a sample size actually become large enough to be meaningful? The answer, for statisticians, would be 30. Yes, just 30. That's already big enough a sample to apply the central limit theorem, for instance. Now, I'm not a statistician by any means, but I could imagine that it would be a little more complicated than that when it comes to League of Legends. Like, do we need at least 30 games that ended pre-15 minutes, and at least 30 that go hyper late game, etc.? Anyway, even the sample sizes for the uncommon keystones of Press the Attack and Conqueror are at least 9 times bigger than 30, so I'm carefully assuming that the samples are sufficiently large here. But even though survivorship bias and lack of sample size do not seem to be a problem for this dataset, it still tells us surprisingly little. At first glance, you see the vastly popular Lethal Tempo keystone with a solid win rate, you see Conqueror with a trash win rate and nobody even plays it anymore, and you see a very promising win rate on Fleet Footwork with a sizable player base. Could it be Sleeper OP? Tomorrow's metagame? All of these conclusions would be viable if keystones were assigned to players randomly, but they aren't. Let's think about the kind of person who would pick Conqueror Jinx for a second. Of course, there are no studies about the kind of person who would pick Conqueror Jinx, and there never will be, but let's rely on good old reasoning and deduction skills here. We know that Conqueror Jinx was crazy popular and powerful a couple seasons ago, for example, and that Lethal Tempo got a rework during pre-season 12. I will create a persona here for illustration purposes, and I'd like to call him Timmy because alliterations. Timmy took a terrible tower shot in season 10 and got question mark pinged so hard that he quit League of Legends. Now, Timmy also still has fond memories of this game, and his friends finally convinced him to watch the show Arcane, since his former one-trick champion Jinx is one of the show's protagonists. And lo and behold, the show was amazing, and Timmy decided to give the game another shot. He is a competitive guy, but not crazy enough to read years worth of patch notes, so after checking out Jinx in Practice Tool, realizing she is exactly the same, he immediately gets into a ranked game to see what's up. Timmy even bothered to glance at the tooltip of the rune Conqueror, noticing that it also effectively hasn't changed, so it still must be strong on Jinx, right? And yes, I'd say Timmy most likely is right with this. However, after playing a couple of games with good old Conqueror Jinx, Timmy realizes he has lost quite a bit. Is it because Conqueror is bad? No, but because the person who picks Conqueror Jinx in the first place is likely to be somewhat out of touch with the game for one reason or another. I'd actually assume that if we randomly forced half of the Lethal Tempo Jinx players to pick Conqueror instead, hashtag legalize it, that Conqueror's win rate would be sitting at roughly 51%. Or maybe my speculation is trash and Conqueror is objectively weak, but the point is that the data will never be able to tell us. Likewise, self-selection bias is potentially inflating the win rate for Fleet Footwork. The high win rate with the low-ish play rate could be a clue that the Keystone is used by Jinx experts as a tech option for certain matchups. Is Fleet Footwork OP? Possibly, I cannot know just looking at this data, but maybe a player who is mindful enough to already consider their matchups during champ select is just more likely to win to begin with. And this problem doesn't stop with rune choices, but even affects the champions as such. Yasuo currently has an overall win rate of roughly 53%. But ironically enough, it is entirely possible that he is objectively a 56% win rate champion in the current meta. Maybe the kind of person who plays a lot of Yasuo is also the kind of person who rage quits more frequently than the average player, thereby artificially tanking Yasuo's win rate as a champion. If I could, I would really like to force all, Anivia players to practice Yasuo for a while and then one-trick him for the next month or two and vice versa. Would Yasuo's win rate go up and Anivia's win rate go down? Unfortunately, we will never know, since stat websites will never be able to tell us. Garbage in, garbage out. But I still have some good news for you. At the very least, stat websites can tell you what's currently happening in the meta. What are people playing the most, and what are the threats you will need to deal with? Stat websites will tell you exactly that, and they can also provide some guidance when you want to pick up a new champion. But can they tell you anything about power level? Well, you can maybe somewhat diminish the effects of self-selection bias by looking at drastic changes in win rates over longer periods of time, yet those are quite rare and only occur in extreme cases. However, the real takeaway here should be that individual rune and item choices are not even that important, as long as you pick something that at least makes sense in theory and that you are utilizing effectively. Far more impactful for the outcome of your matches is still your in-game micro and macro decision making, and if you want to avoid common macro pitfalls that can truly cost you the game if you're not aware of them, you should click the link on your screen right there.